This conference will now be recorded.
Diarrhea and food poisoning. So basic, we'll go to the basics of food poisoning and how it food can be contaminated.
While we have all seen the large food recalls of contaminated food or the latest outbreak of foodborne illness on the news, we usually don't think getting sick can happen to us. However, roughly 48 million people in the United States come down with a foodborne illness each year. That's roughly 16% of the entire United States getting sick each year because of something they ate. Foodborne illness is caused by consuming contaminated foods or beverages. Many different disease-causing microbes or pathogens can contaminate foods, so there are many different types of foodborne illnesses. Most foodborne diseases are infections caused by a variety of bacteria, viruses, and parasites. Other diseases are poisonings caused by harmful toxins or chemicals that have contaminated food. People have always gotten sick from food, but with our increased knowledge of pathogen transmission and our ability to determine the source of an illness, foodborne outbreaks are more readily recognized. Food can become contaminated in countless ways during its journey from farm to fork. However, most contamination falls into three general areas during the journey from farm to fork: during growing or pre-harvest, production or post-harvest, or final processing and handling before food is eaten or sold. When food is being grown on a farm, it will be irrigated with water unknowingly contaminated with chemical waste that ran into the earth that's used for irrigation. This food is contaminated during the growing process. For foods of animal origin, contamination with disease-causing bacteria may occur at the time of slaughter or shortly thereafter. Natural bacteria in the animal's intestinal tract, such as salmonella, can get on the surface of the product. Harmful bacteria, such as salmonella, often colonize the intestinal tract of an animal and, in turn, get on the animal's skin or feathers. When the animal is slaughtered, these bacteria can contaminate the surface of the raw meat or poultry. Foods such as deli meat and hot dogs can also be contaminated in factories by microorganisms such as listeria, which can live in the factory environment. The third common cause of food contamination occurs as a result of how food is handled before being served or purchased. For example, the owner of a catering business takes thawed chicken out of the refrigerator to prepare it for cooking. She places it on the countertop to skin it prior to cooking. She gets busy and forgets to clean the countertop. After cooking the chicken, she places it back on the otherwise countertop to cool and cut up. She leaves it on the countertop for 4 hours before returning it to the refrigerator, allowing the foodborne bacteria to happily multiply. The next day, she serves the chicken in her famous cold chicken salad sandwich appetizers. Bon appetit! Foodborne illness is entirely preventable. During the past century in the United States, our public health predecessors in the food industry have successfully reduced or eliminated the burden of many foodborne pathogens, such as typhoid fever. The burden of these foodborne diseases was reduced through a combined effort of better sanitation, public health surveillance, and outbreak investigation, and food processing improvements, such as pasteurization, refrigeration, and freezing, commercial canning procedures, and the implementation of hazard analysis and critical control points, HACCP. In some instances, development of vaccines has played a role in reducing disease incidence. Even though we've had these advances, problems with foodborne illnesses still occur. We are continuing to identify differences in the pathogens causing illness and the people becoming ill. These differences reflect changes in the ways our modern society produces and handles food, changes in dietary patterns, the international source for much of the food that we eat, as well as changes in the susceptibility of portions of our population to illness. People who are more likely to become ill include young children and the elderly, or those who have illnesses that reduce their resistance to infection, such as HIV or cancer. The leading causes of foodborne illness in the United States today are norovirus, salmonella, and Clostridium perfringens, with over 50% caused by norovirus alone. The highest causes of death from foodborne illness are Salmonella, Toxoplasma gondii, and Listeria monocytogenes. In recent years, trends in foodborne illness in the United States include increases in the incidence of salmonella, campylobacter, and vibrio, and a decrease in incidence of yersinia, listeria, sugar toxin producing Escherichia coli, O157, and Shigella. In addition to the health burden, the financial burden of the individual and industry can be heavily impacted as a result of a foodborne illness or outbreak. Financial implications to an individual may include lost wages or job, medical care costs, and an ongoing physical disability. Foodborne outbreaks can have devastating financial impacts on the industry, including costs to recall contaminated food, reduced consumer demand for the implicated product or brand, costs to implement food safety process improvements, potential lawsuits, imposed fines by government regulators, and marketing efforts to drive improvement of consumer product or brand perceptions after an outbreak. In the face of a potential foodborne outbreak, public health investigators hold a difficult position. When a foodborne outbreak is detected, the public must be rapidly informed to reduce potential morbidity and mortality. However, public health workers must realize that this critical objective is not without consequences, and that accurate empirical evidence must be obtained and followed prior to any public announcement, as some of your fellow citizens' livelihoods will inevitably be negatively impacted.
I still don't fully understand the different people can help from a single food source. Has our food production system changed that much?
Today, our food production system is global in scale and vastly complex. But let's go back in time to gain a better understanding of how the human food production system has evolved and how large multi-state foodborne outbreaks can occur. The first evidence of human food production emerges during the Neolithic era around 9500 BC. Prior to then, humans are thought not to have used agriculture, but were hunter-gatherers, sharing limited amounts of food among small, geographically dispersed groups. With the advent of agriculture, food was available in sufficient quantities to sustain human settlements. However, as these settlements grew, so did the potential threat of disease transmission from interaction among humans, increases in human waste, and an ever-growing need for more livestock. Undoubtedly, many of these diseases were foodborne pathogens. During the following centuries, agriculture advances allowed for an increase in the scale of the food system, and it was the Industrial Revolution that brought about a whole new food production paradigm. One of the key elements in this new model was transportation. Investments in railroads and canals made it faster and more efficient to move food from the field to a simple processing facility. As a result, food grown out of the Great Plains of the United States could be shipped to Chicago or New York for processing, and then out to the populous retail markets before spoilage. While the new food production model reduced financial costs for producers and consumers alike, it also increased the risk for foodborne illness. If food was contaminated in a central processing facility, for example, through poor sanitation practices, that food was now reaching many more people. The mechanical, technological, and biological advances realized in the past 100 years have allowed a regional and then national-wide food production system to rapidly expand into an intertwined global food market. Today, consumers experience in their local grocery store relatively cheap, fresh products from around the world to allow for year-round availability. In addition, grocery stores in the United States have undergone a transformation in the number of items they offer to consumers. In 1960, grocery stores sold on average 5,900 separate products. By 1979, that number increased to 7,800. These numbers are dwarfed by today's standards, where a grocery store sells on average 42,686 separate products. Even a small slip in food safety among the large number of different products sold today has significant potential to cause illness in many people. Through diligent public health work and regulation, safe food in the modern age has become widely available and is now expected by consumers. However, oversight on the global food production system to ensure all produced food is safe is not possible. Most food producers ensure their products meet the highest of standards. However, when food contamination events do occur, they are likely to have a regional, national and potentially even a global effect because of our modern food production model. Therefore, a large number of people are potentially at risk of developing illness. While egregious food contamination is readily identified by public health surveillance systems, low-level food contamination is difficult to detect due to fewer people becoming ill across a wide food distribution area. To react to the changing food production system, public health surveillance systems are employing the use of new laboratory and technological techniques to allow public health investigators greater probability in detecting foodborne outbreaks that have cases spread across large geographical areas. As a result, local and state public health foodborne outbreak investigators may find themselves working with national partners at CDC and FDA to put the pieces together to solve a foodborne outbreak. In our next video, we'll introduce you to the United States federal agencies that regulate the food industry and investigate foodborne outbreaks, particularly.
Okay. So now you understand how food can be contaminated, how a number of people can become sick together due to contamination in food. So today's topic is diarrhea and food poisoning. So we'll go over the basic organisms that can cause these conditions and potentially how to detect them. So as you know, most gastrointestinal tract infections are transmitted by food and water contamination. And it can be the fecal cycle can be broken by proper sewage disposal, disinfection of drinking water, and proper food preparation and storage. So the normal flora, actually, a lot of organisms stay all over the gastrointestinal tract. And as you see in this diagram, in different parts of the gastrointestinal tract, there are different number of organisms like the enterococci, bacteroids, bifidobacterium, mucobacterium, peptococcus, peptostreptococcus, ruminococcus, clostridia, lactobacilli. So there are a number of organisms which stay all over the gastrointestinal tract. And food poisoning is basically an acute enteric infection, which is caused by either bacteria or the toxins which may be present in food at consumption. So infectious agents include bacteria, viruses, and parasites. And toxic agents include fungal toxins like poisonous mushrooms, as we discussed about mycotoxins in the previous class, scombrotoxin, which can be from a fish from mackerel family, or pesticides, which can be present on foods and vegetables. So the symptoms can develop rapidly. There is a time gap between the consumption of food and the development of symptoms, and that can be an indicator of what the potential organism can be. So it can be within 30 minutes to 1 hour or slowly, which can worsen over days to weeks. And the most common contaminants cause nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and abdominal cramping. And food poisoning may not be serious, but the illness may run its course for over 24 to 48 hours at minimum. So suppose vomiting occurs only after an hour or so after food consumption, what may be the causes? So it can be Staphylococcus aureus enterotoxin, which is a super antigen, as we discussed in the class about staphylococci. So that is a super antigen, which directly binds to the receptors on T cells. And this, suppose the toxin is actually preformed. This Staphylococcus aureus enterotoxin is a preformed toxin. And once the food which contains the protein is cooked, the bacteria may be killed, but it can be contaminated by staphylococci, which can be present on hands when the competing bacteria have been eliminated. And once it is held at room temperature, naturally the organisms incubate in the food and they can release the toxins. So once the food containing the toxins is eaten, naturally it can produce a very serious condition within a matter of 1 to 6 hours. So within a very short time, there will be the symptoms of food poisoning. So diarrhea is usually not a typical feature of this kind of food poisoning, but this type of food poisoning is quite common actually. So it can be also Bacillus cereus, which is a spore-forming bacillus. You might have read along with Bacillus anthracis that about Bacillus cereus, and ingestion of this bacterial exotoxin produces mild symptoms. So mild symptoms might be there, but this is usually due to reheated fried rice. So if the vomiting is less pronounced, but there is abdominal pain about 12 to 24 hours after contaminated food consumption, then it can be Clostridium perfringens. So this actually grows in the intestinal tract, producing the exotoxin, which results in diarrhea. So it takes some more time as compared to Staphylococci or Bacillus cereus. So this is a common member of the colonic normal flora, but at the same time, it can be contaminated through food. So there can be shigellosis also. So shigella, as you remember, these species produce the toxin known as the shiga toxin. So this shiga toxin produces inflammation and bleeding also. So as you might have been remembering from the chapter shigella, this shigella bacterium, it comes and attaches to the epithelial cells which lie in the intestinal tract. And then they enter into the epithelial cell and rapidly multiply inside the cell. And after multiplication, they go laterally. You can see in this diagram, they go laterally to the nearby cells. So neighboring cells, it goes laterally. So from one cell into the other cells, it goes laterally. And then it produces the infection of the nearby epithelial cells. And because it invades, shigella is something that invades the epithelial cells, because of which you can see blood and mucus in the stools. So please remember this. So because this is an invasive kind of organism and it invades laterally, just remember this thing. So it invades laterally into the neighboring cells, and it naturally it will avoid the immune defenses, and it will produce blood and mucus in the stools. So high level contamination with Salmonella or Campylobacter species may result in a food poisoning like syndrome also, but these species are more typically associated with enteritis caused by bacterial invasion of the intestinal mucosa. So Salmonella species, as you remember, they go further than the Shigella species. They go to the, after invading the epithelial cells, they go to the nearby lymph nodes. They go to the bloodstream. They can stay in the gallbladder, and from time to time, they'll be spilling over into the intestinal tract, and thus they can go to liver and other parts of the reticuloendothelial system, and then they can cause typhoid fever also. So Salmonella go a further step from Shigella, and after invasion they go to the lymph nodes and thus to the bloodstream, and thus they can go all over the body, and they can invade a lot of other members of the reticuloendothelial system. So if this is just an attempt at humor, so you can see, suppose chickens wanted to rule the world, naturally they can cause a Salmonella outbreak. Because from their feces, the Salmonella organisms can remain intact on the shells of eggs, and thus they can cause salmonellosis. So Campylobacter gastroenteritis can also be there, caused by Campylobacter jejuni, which is transmitted with cow's milk and related products. So infective diarrhea is usually a gastroenteritis which results in loose or watery stools, which is caused by the action of microorganisms or their toxins on the intestine. So secretory diarrhea may result in torrential outpouring of fluid into the intestine, with the risk of subsequent hypovolemic shock and renal failure. You have studied about the organisms before, so we'll go in short about these organisms like Vibrio cholerae. So Vibrio cholerae, there are many serotypes, as you might be remembering. The classical one is O1, and then there is the different biotypes are there, like the classical and the LTOR. So there is also Vibrio cholerae O139 or Vibrio cholerae Bengal, which was recently a cause of outbreak. So the toxin, the cholera toxin, is the main causative agent of diarrhea, and it causes the host cells to secrete the ions like chloride ions, the HCO ions, the sodium and the potassium ions to go into the gastrointestinal tract. And naturally, once they go into the GIT, the water follows, and there is huge voluminous rice watery stool, which results, and the patient will become dehydrated very quickly. So there is also Escherichia coli gastroenteritis, which occurs as traveler's diarrhea. You might be remembering the different biotypes of Escherichia coli, and we discussed in class also. So what are the different biotypes? You might be remembering there are five different biotypes. So it can be remembered as the mnemonic as Pita, or in Hindi, Pita means father, P-I-T-A-H, enteropathogenic, enteroinvasive, enterotoxigenic, enteroaggregative, and enterohemorrhagic Escherichia coli. P-I-T-A-H. Please remember this mnemonic. It will be easier for you once a question comes on Escherichia coli diarrhea. So there are different biotypes of Escherichia coli. The mnemonic is Pita. P-I-T-A-H, enteropathogenic, enteroinvasive. Enteroinvasive is exactly like Salmonella diarrhea, Shigella dysentery, because it also produces a toxin similarly and also invades into the cells. So that is enteroinvasive Escherichia coli. And also there is enterohemorrhagic Escherichia coli, and the typical strain is O157H7, as was told in the video. So this also will produce a toxin which is similar to the Shiga toxin, and what it will result is, it can result in hemorrhagic diarrhea. So P-I-T-A-H, don't forget the biotypes of Escherichia coli. So then there is Yersinia enterocolitica, which can produce gastroenteritis. It can reproduce at 4 degrees Celsius. So suppose you store it in the refrigerator also, it will continue to multiply and can be usually transmitted in meat and milk. So there is also viral gastroenteritis, as we discussed in the video. So there are different viruses like the norovirus, the rotavirus. The rotavirus usually in babies. So usually suppose you take a small baby or an infant to the doctor and the baby is suffering from diarrhea, usually the doctor will not prescribe antibiotics, because mostly they are viral, like rotavirus and norovirus, and they heal by themselves usually. So it causes moderate to severe vomiting, followed by watery diarrhea and fever. And it is the most common cause of food poisoning in infants and children. Please remember rotavirus, and rotavirus vaccine is also now available, which is given to babies. So noroviruses are the most common causes, viral causes of adult food poisoning, which is transmitted from water, shellfish, and vegetables, which can be contaminated by feces. And these are usually treated with rehydration, because there is a lot of dehydration due to diarrhea and they heal on their own. So that is why there is no need to give antibiotics in the case of viral gastroenteritis. So there are parasites also, like you might be remembering Giardia lamblia, which can be transmitted by contaminated water, which can be diagnosed by a microscopic examination. You can see the trophozoites, you can see the cysts also. So if you examine the stool for the ova or the trophozoite, and the treatment is with metronidazole. So this is the life cycle of Giardia lamblia, you might be remembering. So the dormant cysts, suppose they are ingested with food, so they exist in the intestine, and then the trophozoite emerges. And it divides with asexual replication by binary fission. They will divide, and then not everybody will exhibit symptoms, but then they will encyst after a certain period of time, and then the trophozoites and the cysts are expelled in stool, and only the cysts can survive outside the host, and they can survive for weeks to months in cold water and on the surfaces of food. So they once they are ingested, again the life cycle will continue. Then there is Cryptosporidium parvum, you might be remembering. So it can be contaminated through contaminated water, it can be transmitted. So the ooze cysts are there of Cryptosporidium parvum, and you might remember that in HIV patients, in patients who are immunocompromised, in patients who have some sort of transplant or who are immunosuppressed with the intake of steroids or other things. So those people will have prolonged diarrhea, especially in HIV patients, once the CD4 counts decrease. So that is why in those people, suppose one HIV patient comes to you with diarrhea, you have to examine the stool with acid pass staining or ELISA for Cryptosporidium parvum, and treatment is with oral rehydration. So Helicobacter pylori, you might remember, it is a cause of peptic ulcer disease, and it can also be the causative agent of stomach cancer. So typhoid, just in short, you might remember that it is caused by Salmonella typhi and paratyphi A, B, and C. And these bacteria, they spread throughout the body in phagocytes, because they survive inside the phagocytes and they can cause systemic infection. But diarrhea is uncommon, but still then you can do stool culture, you can do blood culture, you can do urine culture, and then you can diagnose. So there are systemic complications because they go all over the body, and what happens is gastroenteritis usually is self-limited, and basically supportive treatment is given to control the symptoms and prevent dehydration. So basically diarrhea has a definition, that is stool weight in excess of 200 grams per day, but usually we do not measure. So what we do is, a good working definition is that three or more loose or watery stools per day, and the patient will tell that my frequency has increased. So three might be normal for some persons. So that is why the patient will usually tell that frequency or the consistency of the stools has changed. So there is a definite decrease in consistency and an increase in frequency based upon the individual baseline, because from individual to individual, the number of stools vary per day. So it increased, there is increased water content of the stool, whether due to impaired water absorption or due to active water secretion by the bowel. So in severe infectious diarrhea, number of stools may reach up to 20 or more per day. So for example, in cholera, it might be a lot more, so because of which the patient dies due to dehydration. So that is why the total volume of stool will exceed 2 liters, with the resultant volume depletion and hyperkalemia. So that is why most patients with acute diarrhea, once they present with 3 to 7 movements per day, and even a total stool volume of less than 1 liter, even though this is common, if the situation requires, you have to treat them. So there are non-infectious causes of diarrhea also, like drugs, like food allergies, or gastrointestinal diseases such as inflammatory bowel disease. So inflammatory bowel disease, you might remember, so many like Crohn's disease can be there, or other disease states such as thyrotoxicosis or carcinoid syndrome, they can also cause diarrhea. So usually in small bowel infections, there is watery diarrhea, there is a large volume of stool, there is abdominal cramping, bloating or gas and weight loss, and fever is a rarely, it is a significant symptom, and usually there is no occult blood or inflammatory cell. And you might remember that diarrhea is different from dysentery. Dysentery is what we discussed in entamoebahistolytica and shigellosis. And dysentery is something in which you will find blood and mucus in the stools, whereas diarrhea is something what we are discussing at present. So in large intestinal infections, there can be frequent stools, which can be regular or small volume and often painful bowel movements, along with fever or bloody or mucoid stools are common, and red blood cells and inflammatory cells may be seen routinely on the stool smear. So acute diarrhea can be less than 14 days in duration, whereas persistent diarrhea is always more than 14 days in duration, whereas chronic diarrhea is more than 30 days in duration. So the bacteria which can cause different types of diarrhea, like Salmonella, there are different species of Salmonella which can cause gastroenteritis. There is Campylobacter, there is Shigella, there is Escherichia coli, different biotypes which we discussed just now, and the more frequent type, which is due to the common fast foods that we intake nowadays, which can be enterohemorrhagic Escherichia coli, like O157H7, and Clostridium difficile diarrhea. So viruses like caliciviruses, like noroviruses or related viruses, rotavirus, just now we discussed, adenoviruses, diarrheagenic adenoviruses like the serotypes 40 and 41, and also astroviruses. So protozoa like Cryptosporidium, just now we discussed, there can be Giardia, there can be Cyclospora. Cyclospora is also found like Cryptosporidium in the cases with HIV or immunocompromised patients. And entamoebahistolytica, which can be a cause of amoebic dysentery. So the etiology is most cases of acute infectious gastroenteritis are probably viral, and stool culture has been positive in very less percentage of cases, because the most cases are viral, like it was discussed in the video. So noroviruses, rotaviruses, other viruses are responsible for a majority of cases. So only in 1.5 to 5.6% of cases, they can be positive for bacterium. So bacterial causes are responsible for many cases of severe diarrhea, and protozoa are less commonly identified as the etiologic agents of acute gastrointestinal illness. So how to diagnose? We have to take a careful history of the patient to determine the duration of the symptoms, the frequency, the characteristics of the stool. You have to ask the patient, you have to ask about other extracellular volume depletion, like decreased skin turgor or orthostatic hypotension, and fever and peritoneal signs can be clues to infection with an invasive enteric pathogen like we discussed in Salmonella or typhoid infection. So what are the indications for diagnostic evaluation? If there is profuse watery diarrhea with signs of hypovolemia or the passage of many small volume stools containing blood and mucus or bloody diarrhea, or if there is increase in temperature or passage of 6 unformed stools per 24 hours or a duration of illness is more than 48 hours, or there is severe abdominal pain or a recent use of antibiotics, like for example, it can be pseudomembranous enteritis or colitis, and if the diarrhea is in the elderly, that is more than 70 years of age or in the immunocompromised, naturally you have to investigate. So there are different causes of small bowel and colon infections, like bacterial infections in the small bowel can be Salmonella, Escherichia coli, Clostridium perfringens, Staphylococcus aureus and Bacillus cereus, Vibrio cholerae, etc. Whereas in bacteria, it can be in the colon, it can be Campylobacter or Shigella or Clostridium difficile, Yersinia, Vibrio parahemolyticus, entero-invasive Escherichia coli or Klebsiella oxidophagum. So there can be other causes also, like for example, viruses like rotavirus or noroviruses, and protozoa like Cryptosporidium, Microsporidium, Isospora, Cyclospora, which are more common in the immunocompromised, and it can be also Giardia lamblia. So cytomegalovirus, adenovirus, herpes simplex virus, or Entamoeba histolytica can also be responsible in the large bowel. So first you have to find out within how much time the symptoms have begun. So that is why if it is within 6 hours, just now we discussed, it can be Staphylococcus aureus or Bacillus cereus, a preformed toxin can be there. Or if it is 8 to 16 hours, it can be Clostridium perfringens. If it is more than 16 hours, it can be due to viral or bacterial infection like contamination of food with enterotoxigenic or enterohemorrhagic Escherichia coli. There can be traveler's diarrhea also. And if there is fecal leukocytes or occult blood, so that is why the role has been questioned. So that is why what you have to do is you have to find out whether occult blood is there, fecal leukocytes are there or not. So in high-risk patients, you have to go for bacterial culture, and fecal leukocyte determination can be like in patients who are hospitalized, it can be also found. So when do you obtain stool cultures, like the patient, if it is an immunocompromised patient like HIV or patient who is having comorbidities with complications, and if severe or inflammatory diarrhea is there or inflammatory bowel disease can be there. So you have, if there is a flare or a superimposed infection, so you have to diagnose. And if there are, these are employees such as food handlers, so those people you have to have negative stool cultures before they return to work. So ova and parasites, naturally you have to send 3 subsequent stool samples for ova and parasite determination. So persistent diarrhea, if it is there, it can be associated with Giardia, Cryptosporidium, Entamoeba histolytica, or if it is following travel to a specific region which are associated with Giardia, Cryptosporidium or Cyclospora, or people who have been exposed to infants in daycare centers, or if there is a community waterborne outbreak or a bloody diarrhea with few or no fecal leukocytes. So treatment is naturally with oral rehydration solutions and empiric antibiotic therapy. So basically you have to rehydrate the patient. Dehydration is usually a symptom in the case of diarrhea. So that is why if you have to start antibiotic therapy, you have to weigh the pros and cons, and then you have to start the treatment. So a little bit about Shigella infection in adults. So it is a common cause of bacterial diarrhea worldwide, and it is because the organism is not as susceptible to acid, so that is why the inoculum can be very less. 10 to 100 organisms can cause disease because they can survive the transit through the stomach. So what happens is they can be transmitted from person to person as well as through contaminated food and water. And it is a cause of classic dysentery, that is blood and mucus in the stools. So what happens is there is fever in about 30 to 40% of the cases, and abdominal pain, mucoid diarrhea, bloody diarrhea, or even watery diarrhea sometimes. And vomiting can be also there. So the incubation period is 1 to 7 days, and it can be quite severe with fever, anorexia, and malaise. And initially, the diarrhea is watery, but subsequently, as invasion goes on occurring, subsequently, it will contain blood and mucus. So tenesmus is a frequent complaint. So the patient will come and tell that I'm having tenesmus after passing stools or during the passage of stools. So the stool frequency is typically 8 to 10 per day, but it can increase to a lot more. They are small volume and there can be significant weight loss as well. So how to diagnose bloody stools or mucoid stools? The patient will complain. He'll have abdominal cramps and tenesmus. It can be accompanied by fever. Nausea and vomiting are notably absent in many of the patients. And fecal leukocytes are generally present because of invasion. So thank you so much for your patient listening. I hope that you understood a lot of things about diarrhea and dysentery and about food poisoning. We discussed most of the important points and we discussed most of the important organisms that are responsible. So can any one of you summarize what we discussed today's class? Yes. Roll number 101, Sunanda, Lakshmi Sunanda. Can you summarize today's class? Yes. Just whatever we discussed, whatever you remember, just you say so that I'll also understand that you could hear me. Yes? Anybody else? Anybody else who can summarize? Sindhu Anusha, roll number 113. Can you unmute yourself and just summarize what we discussed? Yes, anyone? Roll number 17, Deepthi. Deepthi, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Deepthi, whatever you remember, just summarize. Yes, ma'am, I can hear you. Yeah, please summarize so that just I know that I was audible and a lot of important points what we discussed. Whatever you remember, just tell.
Okay, ma'am. Most of the causes, etiology of the diarrhea are by fecal-oral route.
Yes.
And that is to food and water contamination.
Yes.
And that is to poor sanitary facilities, sewage.
Yes, sewage contamination. Yes.
And bacterial causes like bacteria that is causing diarrhea are Salmonella, Shigella, Campylobacter.
Yes.
Bacillus cereus.
Yes, very good. If
and,
it is within 1 to 6
parasites,
hours, what is
Vibrio cholera.
Yes.
Parahemolyticus.
Yes, Vibrio parahemolyticus.
Shigella is dysentery, bloody dysentery.
Yes.
And parasites causing the diarrhea, examples are Giardia lamblia, Entamoeba histolytica, Cryptosporidium. Cyclospora,
yes.
Isospora.
Yes.
And then and viral causes, virus that is causing diarrhea are rotavirus, norovirus,
yes.
Adenoviruses, and
yes.
Herpes simplex virus.
Yes.
And the common symptoms of symptoms that are causing diarrhea like common symptoms, sorry ma'am, like symptoms like abdominal pain, fever, vomiting, nausea.
Yes. If it is a preformed toxin like Staphylococcus aureus, yes, it can occur.
And the
in
case of preformed toxins, the symptoms are very within 30 minutes or within hours, the symptoms occur. And if
yes,
the toxin is if the toxin has to be synthesized in the intestine, then the symptoms to occur, it takes time.
Yes, it takes
like
some time
8 to 16 hours.
Yes, And you understood the differences between acute diarrhea, persistent diarrhea, and chronic diarrhea? Acute diarrhea is usually less than 14 days, whereas persistent diarrhea will be at least for more than or equal to 14 days, whereas chronic diarrhea is for 30 days or more. Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Thank you so much, Deepthi. Please clap for Deepthi in your houses. Yes. Very well done, Deepthi. Thank you so much. Okay. So now we'll end the class with a very positive note. Thank you, Deepthi. So it is positive for me as well as others. So that a lot of important points you could hear and you could understand. And I hope to meet you next time in some other class where we'll discuss about some other syndromes. So I hope that you and your families are safe. And please stay home as much as possible. Whenever you are going out, please wear your mask, gloves, whatever it is, and reduce going out as much as possible. Okay, stay safe, take care of yourselves. Thank you so much for attending today's class. I'm stopping the class right now.